In January 1944, on either side of Italy, two Allied armies, one British, the other American, slowly pushed their way northwards from Naples towards Rome. Finally, they came upon Germany's main defensive position to the south of Rome, known as the Gustav Line. Anchored on one of the strongest natural defenses in Europe, the formidable defenses had been strengthened by months of preparation and were manned by crack German troops. For 5 long months in bitter weather, the Allies attacked the German defenses. Divisions from America, Britain, New Zealand, India, Poland, and France saw action in 4 savage battles before the German resistance finally broke. This was Monte Cassino.
The Allied had the blind vision of attacking the monastery frontal, go up and go up and go up, and they were just picked off like rabbits.
The sergeant came round, he called out a name, he said, I want you all to go over in the corner of the field, the priest will hear your last confession. And I thought, my last confession? That means to say that my chances of survival is nil.
I feel they should have bypassed the casino. They could have gone around it.
Death was just split seconds away. And the whole battle itself were awful.
Monte Cassino is remembered not just because it was one of the fiercest battles in a very hard-fought war, but also because it provoked sharp disagreements over strategy between the British and American allies, exposing the great difficulties of coalition warfare. The campaign also saw the bombing of the great ancient monastery at Monte Cassino, a cultural and artistic center, mother church to the Benedictine order, and the inspiration of monasticism everywhere in Europe. Divisions between the Allies in part explain why the capture of Monte Cassino proved to be so difficult.
The Americans really never wanted to be in Italy. They somehow felt that the British had tricked them, and they thought that they would be dragged into a campaign that would simply delay what they saw as being far more important, and that was Overlord, the invasion of Normandy, and the opening of a real second front on the European continent.
Churchill wanted to engage the Germans wherever and whenever he could. And Italy is the place where Churchill wants to do it. And the way Churchill wants to do it is the way that will drag the maximum of German resources away from France, away from northern France, away from the intended invasion in Normandy, as well as from Joe Stalin out there fighting the Germans on the Eastern Front.
In Churchill's grand vision for victory, Italy was to be occupied, the Balkans set on fire, the Greek islands were to be liberated, and Turkey brought into the war. Axis Europe was to be penetrated and defeated through what he called its soft underbelly. American support for an Italian campaign was therefore given grudgingly, and as a consequence, there were never enough American men, supplies, and equipment to produce a swift result. In addition, there was considerable friction between the Allied commanders. Lieutenant General Mark Clark, who commanded the American Fifth Army, was young and ambitious, but no lover of things British. Sadly, he had a poor relationship with the overall theatre commander, the very British General, the Honourable Sir Harold Alexander.
I think one of the things we must remember about Clark is that he wasn't so much anti-British as pro-Clark. Clark was going to be against anyone, American or British, who stood in his way. Because Clark was a man of immense personal ambition. And if the British thwarted him in his ambition, then he was going to be anti-British. But had it been an American general who was thwarting him, he would have been equally anti that general.
On the German side, the commanders were seasoned professionals. The overall commander in Italy was Field Marshal Albert Kesselring.
Kesselring, an Air Force man, well regarded by his staff, well regarded by his troops. A lot of forethought, a lot of foresight. And particularly when he realised that the Allies were going to invade Italy, he'd had the sense to realise that the way to deal with it was by a slow withdrawal up the leg of Italy.
Under him, and in command at Monte Cassino, was an even more remarkable man, Fridolin von Senger und Etterlin.
Monte Cassino is his battle. First of all, the defensive preparations are brilliantly done. And as the battle develops, he goes forward, he knows what his soldiers need on the ground. He gives them both the reassurance of a man who knows what he's doing and the supplies and the ammunition necessary to fight the battle.
The Gustav Line lay across the two best north-south roads in Italy, connecting Rome with Naples. A great steep spur led to the coast from the impassable mountains of central Italy. At the end of this spur, dominating the two valleys below, stood the Benedictine Monastery. At the foot of Monastery Hill lay the market town of Cassino, through which ran the best of the two main roads. Finally, issuing from the mountain pass and swirling past the town to the coast, was the Rapido River, only 60 feet wide, but 10 feet deep and flowing fast at 8 miles an hour. Mountain, town, and river thereby combined to block any Allied attempt to break into the wide and flat Liri Valley, the direct route to Rome.
It was a good military place. I mean, high ground always is in a battle. You can look over the countryside as the advantage.
The Abbey of Monte Cassino, there it stands. Highway 6 running across the back there, around the base of the hill, and then onwards and upwards towards Rome. They'd had 3 months in which to prepare the defences across the waistline of Italy, across from the Adriatic through to the Gulf of Gaeta. And the key to this whole defensive line was this building behind.
You couldn't get up the hill without being seen. There's not a lot of vegetation on Monastery Hill. There's a lot of open ground around it, making it difficult even to approach the hill without being seen. But you cannot get up the Liri Valley without going past Monte Cassino.
It was the cork in the bottle on the route to Rome.
The Führer expects the bitterest struggle for every yard, read a German order of the day, and von Senger's men prepared for exactly that. The valley in front of Cassino was flooded to make it impossible for tanks. Mines and barbed wire were laid along the Rapido River. Mortars and machine guns were posted on the German side. The town's entire population was expelled. Its larger buildings were reinforced to become fortresses, while smaller ones were demolished to clear fields of fire. On the mountain itself, holes were blasted in the bare rock and camouflaged prefabricated bunkers and pillboxes with sides and roof of 5-inch thick steel plate were slotted into position. Smaller, 2-man weapon pits were blasted out and lined with concrete. Machine guns were placed on every slight rise along the ridgelines in order that their interlocking fire could sweep the entire area. Finally, observers in the hills were connected to a fire control plan that could bring down a deadly barrage of mortar and artillery fire within minutes.
Once when we got to Cassino, we were absolutely trapped there. And if you couldn't even have hot tea or anything in the daytime because they saw the slightest bit of smoke. They'd put a shell down where the smoke was.
You just couldn't move at all. They could look right over your positions. You were constantly being mortared and shelled. But in retaliation, you had the right to call down the defensive fire from your side, and all hell was let loose.
Lieutenant General Clark's 5th Army, which included American, British and French troops, toiled up to the German Gustav line on the 15th of January, 1944. The assault on the position began a mere 48 hours later, an impossibly short time to plan and prepare for a major attack, and the result was a predictable disaster. On the extreme left, near the coast, British troops forced a crossing of the river, but were pinned down and unable to expand their bridgehead. Worse than this, the American 36th Texas Division in the center was, in 2 days and nights, destroyed as a fighting unit. Even to reach the Rapido River, the troops had had to flounder across 2 miles of swamp and mud laced with barbed wire and studded with mines. Some attacks were made at night in a rising fog, under heavy artillery and machine gun fire. Incredibly, a number of troops managed to get across the fast-flowing river, but they were immediately pinned down on the other side. Engineers attempted to put up bridges to allow tank support, but these were destroyed almost at once by German shells. More men managed to get across during the day and the following night, but with no tank support and no ammunition resupply, the bridgehead could not be held. A handful of men got back at the end of the second night of the attack, but more than half of the attacking troops had been lost.
Well, the Rapido crossings were an attempt to bounce the Gustav line, to bounce the Germans out of their defenses. And of course it didn't work, because it was the middle of winter, everything was against it, it was under observation. The Germans had been able to build up a very strong position on the Gustav line, and so the attempts to cross within the night and establish a big enough bridgehead to secure the bridges that you needed to take your tanks across just simply wasn't possible.
Only on the extreme right of the Allied line was there any progress. 2 miles upriver from Cassino town, the American 34th Division forced a crossing of the river, and after 8 days had battered their way to the foot of the mountain that rose from the valley of the Rapido. They now had to climb the sheer slopes of the mountain in order to fight their way onto the ridge that curled leftwards to the monastery and domination of the valleys below. For a week, they struggled on, clearing the steep crags from where German machine gunners had swept the rocks below them with their deadly fire.
A first sergeant came along and he says, what's going to happen? We're going to have a rolling barrage starting at 3 o'clock, and at 3:15 it will rise and you'll follow through. And that's what happened. So at 3:15 it started to rise, so we followed through. We were walking along the path, and suddenly we came under small arms fire.
The 34th Division got to within 1,000 yards of the monastery, but there they stopped, an absolutely spent and exhausted force.
Our BAR man rolled over to reload his weapon, and a German hand grenade, a potato masher, flipped and fell, and he rolled back on top of the grenade, and it went off and severely wounded him in the stomach. And he came running back saying, I'm hit, will I die? And I says, no, if you just relax, take it easy, just relax, lay down and don't move, don't run around.
The first battle of Monte Cassino had ended after 3.5 weeks. At terrible cost, the Fifth Army had punched a small crossing on the left of the line, fought their way into the mountains on the right, and had been disastrously repulsed in the center. The German line had been tested and had held firm, though some units in the mountains had suffered huge casualties. Von Senge und Etterlin was no doubt reasonably content with the situation. It was now early February 1944, and the pace was hotting up. Three divisions of the British 8th Army were already being brought across Italy to start the second Battle of Cassino. 50 miles to the north, at Anzio, two divisions of the 5th Army were in danger of annihilation. Frustrated by the slow progress of the Italian campaign, Churchill had insisted on an amphibious landing at Anzio, which lay behind the German lines.
Churchill's concept is go around the Gustav line, a step towards Rome, land on the beach there, and even if you can't actually land on the beach there and destroy the Germans, you'll force the Germans to commit troops to attacking that landing. You'll draw them away from the rest of the Gustav line. You'll weaken the Gustav line. And when the Germans weaken the Gustav line, that's when you hit them.
The fact was that the disastrous first attack on Cassino had been improvised in such haste because it had to coincide with the Anzio landing on the 22nd of January. It was hoped that the Anzio campaign would panic the Germans out of their defenses and into a retreat. But there was no panic and no retreat. The Allies had only enough landing craft to put two divisions ashore at Anzio. Too weak a force to be a real threat.
Because they were limited to two divisions, the needs to establish a bridgehead and then advance and secure more ground was simply beyond the capabilities available. And here we have the reality of the Italian campaign always taking second place to the needs of the planning for Overlord and Normandy.
Kesselring quickly saw an opportunity to inflict a bloody reverse on the Allies by driving them back into the sea. So Cassino had to be attacked again to draw off at least some of Kesselring's troops. Anzio had been conceived as a way of helping the Cassino attack. Now Cassino had to save Anzio. So there would be another hasty attack on Cassino, but this time it would be by Commonwealth troops. The New Zealand Division and the 4th Indian Division were both crack forces. Indeed, Rommel himself rated the New Zealanders as among the best troops he ever fought. The 4th Indian Division, too, was highly thought of, being composed of long-service, highly professional Sikhs and Gurkhas, as well as a brigade of English troops. Commanding both divisions was General Bernard Freyberg, decorated 3 times in the First World War and wounded so often that, during dinner parties, Churchill often asked him to take his shirt off to show his guests his many scars.
Everyone in New Freiburg agreed that he was one of the bravest men they'd ever met. But there's a question mark hanging over Freiburg's competence. Some say that he reached his level of competence at divisional command and shouldn't have actually gone in any higher. I think Freiburg's problem is that in Casino, nobody but nobody was going to be able to make it work. And Freiburg did better than most generals could have under the circumstances.
Freiburg's plan for this second attack was simple. The New Zealand division were to assault the railway station to the south of Casino town, which would enable Allied armour to get around the town and into the Leary Valley, the route to Rome. Meanwhile, in the mountains, the Indian division would continue the attack from where the Americans had stalled and press on along a narrow ridge to take the monastery. This plan put the ancient monastery squarely in the line of fire. Although it was right in the center of the German line, the Germans always insisted that they had not fortified the monastery, nor put any troops into it. The Germans also very publicly removed the monastery's treasures and evacuated all its monks, apart from the aged abbot and half a dozen companions. Freiburg was now faced with a tough decision. The Germans certainly had gun pits placed right up to the monastery walls, and few were inclined to trust their assurances that there were no guns within the walls themselves.
There was a lot of discussion as to whether it was right to bomb the monastery. We knew they were in it, although they said they weren't. But if they weren't in it, they were just outside it with their OPs, observation posts.
I wouldn't say there were Germans there. I don't say they were using it as a gun position. I'm sure they used it as a observation, because it really, you could see all over the valley.
Freiburg was concerned that it would be a tactical liability. A lot of Americans were concerned that it was a tactical liability. They believed that it was just chock full of German soldiers and German guns. Why not blow it up? Why take the risk? Why send boys home to New Zealand in boxes or bury them in Italy just because you don't want to blow up a building?
The New Zealand commanders were not prepared to lose men on the strength that the Germans may not be in the monastery. And so a decision was made to bomb the monastery.
There were snipers on top of the monastery. After they bombed the monastery, then they went in, of course.
But not before?
No.
Mm-hmm. 142 flying fortresses and 112 medium bombers dropped 576 tons of bombs on Monte Cassino. The walls remained mostly intact, but the interior courtyards, church, and monastic buildings were totally destroyed.
When the monastery was bombed, the troops cheered and cheered and cheered, because they hated this overwhelming presence above them, like an avenging angel.
I don't think they had no need to bomb the damn thing. They wouldn't. It hasn't served any purpose whatsoever. It actually helped. As soon as that was bombed, they were in.
Abbott and his companion survived the attack and gave the Germans a statement confirming that there had been no troops in the building when it was bombed. In view of the immense controversy caused by the bombing, it was ironic that it gave no benefit at all to the troops it was most designed to help.
Once the monastery was bombed, there was a then, instead of making the attack go in right away, it sort of faded a bit for a few hours before the attack went in. In that time, it gave the Germans time to get their machine gun set up, and they created havoc amongst the advancing troops.
After the bombing of the monastery, there went the 4th Regiment went into that because they were the biggest fortress you can imagine.
The Indians, newly arrived on the mountain, occupied half of the long, narrow, boomerang-shaped ridge that led onto Monastery Hill. Their attack on the monastery, barely 1,000 yards away, was supposed to start from a rocky hillock on the ridge named Point 593. But this was still in German hands when the bombing took place, and there it remained. For 3 nights in succession, English and Indian troops tried to creep along the narrow ridge and storm Point 593 to get at the monastery. They tried first at company strength, then battalion, and then with 3 battalions. It was the same result each time. The attacks were beaten back with huge losses. The mountain assault simply had to be given up. For each night, half the attackers had been killed or wounded. Sufficient numbers could never be concentrated on the long, narrow ridge to capture it. Freyberg's other attack, however, in the valley against the railway station, came agonizingly close to success. Made at night by 2 companies of the New Zealand Division, they gained a foothold during the heavy fighting. But daylight brought a determined counterattack by German tanks and infantry that left the New Zealanders with no option but to retreat. More than half their number were killed or wounded during the attack.
Freyberg decides to cancel the battle, to close it down, at that point where some commentators have said that the New Zealanders had actually almost succeeded in taking Casino. Now, he was actually right to close down the battle at this point, because even if he'd succeeded in holding on to the railway station, what good was it going to do?
No matter what you do in the railway station, no matter what you do in the surrounding buildings, look up the hill. Look up the hill, because up the hill, Monastery Hill, there are the Germans. And the Germans can look down and they can drop mortar bombs on you, call in artillery on you, shoot at you with machine guns, anything they want. Because whatever you do at the railway station, Monastery Hill is still looming over you.
Meanwhile, Germans launched their heaviest attack yet on Anzio. Somehow, the Allies held their position, but they knew full well that Germans would attack again, and therefore the pressure on Casino could not be relaxed. But pressure where? Mountain, river and valley floor had been tried without success. There was one last possibility. A 2-pronged attack from the north, one prong into the town and the other just above it along the lower slopes of Monastery Hill, that would find enough dry ground to permit tank support for the infantry. A successful attack here would allow both monastery and town to be cleared, and the 600 Allied tanks to burst into the Leary Valley and on to Anzio and Rome. To support the attacking battalions, a new tactic was planned. The town of Casino and its defenders were to be attacked from the air by hundreds of heavy bombers.
Heavy bombers were needed to support the infantry because they had nothing else that was big enough to do the job. But of course that created problems in itself because the British and the Americans weren't that good at cooperation between air and ground. And they had never experimented using
strategic bombers, heavy bombers, in support of ground operations.
The Germans had made their preparations too. Artillery, machine guns and dug-in tanks laced the lower slopes of Monastery Hill, and the strong stone houses of the town, reinforced with concrete and steel, concealed tanks and automatic weapons. Significantly, the weary German troops were replaced by the elite Hermann Göring Parachute Division, its seven battalions renewing hostilities with the same troops it had expelled from Crete 3 years earlier. The weather then took a hand. At least three fine days in succession were required for the ground to dry out and for the bombers to hit their targets. But it rained continuously for 3 weeks, during which time the troops had to remain in position lest the weather should change. Finally, on the 15th of March, the weather cleared and Operation Bradman began. 500 bombers arrived in relays to drop more than 1,000 tons of bombs on the small town of Cassino.
The way they bombed it, they didn't, let's say, if that's the mountain going this way, they didn't come head on with the mountain, they went along the valley as they unloaded it. And that's never been known, that a front line were bombed like that with bombers.
Two files of New Zealanders, preceded by tanks, began moving southwards into the town, and a third climbed onto the lower slopes of Monastery Hill to dig the Germans out of Castle Hill, an important rise on the ridge halfway between the town and the monastery.
They did the Germans actually a favour with turning that village into smithereens, because when the tanks came and all of the Germans, they couldn't go anywhere near it because they were stuck there. That's it. Then the infantry had to take over, and of course that were one-to-one, that were easier than fighting tanks, you see.
No tank could penetrate the chaos, and the advance slowed as troops struggled to clear a way for them. They were further hampered by Germans who opened fire from the rubble, although half of the 360 parachute men in the town were already dead. But that night, the Germans sent in reinforcements, concentrating their resistance around and inside two large hotels, the Continental and the Roses, which were at the southern end of the town. As the fighting in the town became a stalemate, so did the battle for the slopes of Monastery Hill. Castle Hill was taken as Gurkhas and Punjabi troops in the action once more held on for a week with virtually no food or water. And the Germans lost an entire battalion trying to retake it.
I know to my right, one group, they were approached by the Germans and they lent them some stretchers, and the Germans used them to cart their dead away and then return the stretchers with a letter of thanks.
But after 5 days and nights of continuous fighting, the Allied troops were depleted and exhausted.
And now Freyberg knew that 2nd New Zealand Division simply could not advance any further. He had reports from his brigade commanders said that it's spent, it's exhausted. And when Freyberg was asked why he was cancelling the attack, he replied with a single word, Passchendaele. He was not going to repeat the mistakes of the First World War of reinforcing failure.
Though he hated giving best once again to the parachute troops, Freyberg decided to consolidate his gains and not to risk further heavy losses on more attacks. As it was, neither the Indian division nor the New Zealanders would ever be quite the same force again. The end of the Third Battle of Casino on the 24th of March brought a relatively calm period of 6 weeks. With the Anzio beachhead now secure, General Alexander, the commander of the invasion, was at last free to plan an attack carefully and thoroughly, at a time and place of his own choosing. He intended not merely a breakthrough at Casino, but a battle to encircle and destroy all the German forces in Italy.
Eighth Army was travelling up the east coast of Italy, and then the American Fifth Army, with a lot of British divisions in it and French, had made attacks on Casino, which had failed. So General Alexander and General Lees concocted a plan of bringing secretly the Eighth Army across from the east to the west.
Alexander then planned an attack along the entire length of the German line, from the coast to the mountains. There were to be no more desperate attacks along narrow corridors of 1,000 yards or less. The Germans would have to repel a coordinated assault along 20 miles of front. When his 16 divisions had broken through and were pursuing the Germans up the Liri Valley to Rome, Alexander intended the Anzio force, now built up to 6 divisions, to break out and block their retreat. Caught south of Rome between the hammer of the Casino force and the anvil of the Anzio troops, the German 10th and 14th armies would be annihilated.
It is a strategy that looks Russian in the meticulous preparation, in the attack on a broad front in order to disperse the enemy, followed by a massive concentration on a narrow sector of front in order to break through the enemy. Alexander took a lot of time. This was not going to be another hasty little operation.
The key to the success of the plan was secrecy and deception. 9 whole divisions were moved across Italy without the Germans noticing. When 2 Polish divisions were moved into the line, they were given English signalers for their radios, lest German eavesdroppers should hear their distinctive accents. In addition, an elaborate cover plan was laid on to convince the Germans that the Allied spring attack would involve another amphibious assault, this time to the north of Rome. It all went, in the phrase of the time, like a marble clock. So complete was the surprise that von Senger was actually on leave when the blow fell.
On the 11th of May, in the evening, when it was just breaking dark, there were no shelling going on. It was a funny, eerie, no artillery, it was quiet as a mouse. And we kept saying, this mate of mine in the foxhole, we kept saying, there's something coming, there's something going on.
HR was at 11 o'clock, 2300 hours in the evening, and the BBC was going to send a signal out so that all these 1,100 guns on our front and the rest on the American front could open up at exactly at that time.
The whole front line towards the, which you could see, that's what going towards Naples, just in the distance in the hills, it just appeared as if somebody was switching all the lights on. Thousand pieces of artillery opened up and they bombarded it and kept on and on and on and on. And that's when the push started.
On the extreme left, next to the sea, 2 American divisions were repulsed. Inland, a little further, however, 2 French divisions began breaking into the mass of the Orinchi Mountains. In the Rapido Valley, scene of the disastrous first battle, British and Indian troops forced their way across the river. The Germans there received another unpleasant surprise as two British tanks followed the infantry, each carrying a section of a bridge on its turret. They drove straight into the river and stopped. Engineers then joined the sections together, and the first tanks rumbled quickly over to extend the bridgehead. On the extreme right, the Poles found the mountain defenses as difficult to overcome as before, and their first night's attack brought no gain. But with two divisions, they could now attack the German strong points on the adjacent ridges, whose crossfire had crippled the Indian division's earlier attacks. They began making progress, but it was the French attack in the left center through the supposedly impassable Orinchi Mountains and toward the Liri Valley which began to unhinge the German line. Already under pressure in the center from the British crossing of the Rapido, the Germans fell back 6 miles to their next line of defense. Ironically, the monastery was eventually taken without a fight.
We got the order to move out to retreat on the 17th during the night, which we did. We went up the mountain of the monastery, and that's where I got wounded on top. And then I crawled into the first aid post, into the monastery. When the 18th came, when daylight broke, I remember one lot shouting, he said, the Tommies are coming. Because they're all Allies had the same type of uniform, you know, with a flat helmet type of thing. And when it all turned out to be when they came in the platoon, it were the Polish platoon.
We fought our way half out the valley and we stopped. And we consolidated our positions. And that morning we looked up and everybody was saying, look, look, look. And on top of the monastery flew a red and white flag, which was the Polish flag. And we looked up and down the mountainside come the Germans with a white flag to surrender. And that was the fall of the monastery.
I've written down here, the 18th, a great day for the 8th Army, 4th British Division entered Casino. It was a big day for the Poles, and their flag and the Union Jack flew together over the monastery. In the afternoon, General Oliver, that's General Lees, and I drove into the Casino. The town is a complete shell, at a distance rather like a strange drawing of a fairy tale town. The monastery, a huge ruin, towers over the town.
Several days of hard combat saw the last German line broken, and the Allies at last began to fight their way up the Liri Valley, delayed by German mines, booby traps and rear guards, and their own traffic jams. The euphoria at breaking the Casino line, however, was short-lived. It was replaced by disappointment, frustration and anger. There were two reasons. Firstly, although the six divisions at Anzio broke out of the German ring as planned and began fighting their way eastwards to cut off the German retreat from Casino, Lieutenant General Clark suddenly ordered a substantial part of the force northwards. The small force remaining was inadequate to bottle up the retreating Germans, who swept into and out of Rome and onto positions 100 miles further north. Why did Clark order this extraordinary change of direction? He claimed afterwards that he had to engage strong German forces on his left flank that threatened his supply lines to the beach. Others have expressed a different view, pointing out that Clark had spoken frequently of Rome as the great prize.
Because of the distrust between the Americans and the British, Clark always believed that Alexander would not let him be the man to take Rome.
Mark Clark saw himself as a 20th century Napoleon. He thought Rome and being the first to Rome was just reward for what his army had endured in the winter of 1944.
Whatever the truth, Clark had his moment of glory as he led American troops into Rome on the 4th of June 1944. But 48 hours later, his Roman triumph was overshadowed by the invasion of Normandy and the opening of the long-awaited Second Front. The second disappointment was caused by the Allied grand strategy. At the Americans' insistence, the invasion of Normandy was to be followed and supported by an invasion of southern France. Accordingly, General Alexander was forced to surrender 7 of his best divisions for the invasion. With them, his chance of bouncing the Germans quickly out of Italy. It was a frustrating end to a frustrating campaign.
At the heart of what happened in Italy is the fact that the whole Mediterranean strategy was deeply flawed. One does not invade a mountainous peninsula from the south and then fight one's way north. This is just stupid.
The question is still debated. Was there an alternative to the Italian campaign? Was the bloody struggle for Cassino warranted? I think the reality is yes. What was happening in the spring offensive at Cassino meant that important divisions and very good divisions that would have been invaluable to the Germans in Normandy and Northwest Europe weren't available because they were in Italy.
Five war cemeteries exist at Cassino, one for each nation that fought in the battle. 20,000 soldiers are buried in the German cemetery alone. Amid the bustle of tourists in the rebuilt town and monastery, the endless ranks of crosses are all that is left to remind the visitor of the sacrifices made during this most savage of battles.
He were classed as Verdun from the First World War at Monte Cassino, where they fought over a piece of land for month and month and month, backwards and forwards, backwards and forwards. I would not like anybody to go through the same predicament I went through there.
Up into the mountains, on the grim slopes of the old 593, there is this inscription. For our freedom and yours, we soldiers of Poland gave our soul to God, our life to the soil of Italy, our hearts to Poland.